Hello and welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is the show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today's guest is Kemp Powers, writer of the new movie One Night in Miami. Inspired by real events, the movie is a fictional account chronicling one incredible night when Muhammed Ali, Malcolm X, Sam Cooke, and Jim Brown gathered in a Miami hotel room discussing their roles in the civil rights movement and cultural upheaval of the 1960s. Kemp and I discussed adapting his own play into a film, how his previous work as a journalist informs his screenwriting, the real history behind the film's events, and more. Check it out. Kemp Powers, thank you for taking the time to chat with me today.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So, One Night in Miami, for those folks who haven't had a chance to see the trailer yet or aren't familiar, what is the movie about?
It's actually an adaptation of a play that I wrote back in 2013. And that play is actually based on a very real night, February 25th, 1964. That's the night that Cassius Clay, soon to be known as Muhammad Ali, beat Sonny Liston, became the world heavyweight champion at only 22 years old. Obviously, no one thought Cassius Clay was going to win, so there was no party planned. So he went back to the black section of Miami, because it was still segregated at this time, to his friend Malcolm X's motel room. And he spent the evening in pretty quiet conversation with Malcolm X, his other friends, Jim Brown, the football player, and Sam Cooke, the musician. And the next morning is when he announced to the world that he was in the Nation of Islam. So using that very real event as a jump off point, because it was like, oh, look at that. I just found the Black Avengers. You know, that was too ripe an opportunity to make a stage play and then ultimately a screenplay. But, you know, I wanted to go beyond just like writing fan fiction. So when I first found out about this, I was doing years of research about it with the intention of writing a book about their friendship. This is when I was still a journalist in my previous career. And it's one of those things where it's like, I never got around to writing the book. And then the next thing you know, some years went by, my journalism career ended and my playwriting and screenwriting career had picked up. So I had the benefit of like all this incredible research and knowledge about the four of them that was really able to inform the characterizations I wanted to make of the men on this very special night.
You know, one of the things that to me really struck me about it is that it's a really, you know, it's raw. It's a kind of warts and all portrayal of these guys, but with love, with respect. Can you talk about just sort of bringing that sort of sense into the project?
Exactly. I mean, nowadays, whenever you say like a famous iconic figure and you say humanizing them, humanizing has almost become like a code word for just showing all the warts or showing them misbehaving, showing them behaving out of character. And I really wanted to humanize them by showing them in character, but showing them in character in a way that the public never got to see. The whole concept was, what if you got to be a fly on the wall for a conversation you had no business being privy to? And to me, I thought that was a way more interesting way to humanize these men, because of course there's been so many biographies written about each of the four that all their foibles, all the things they're fallible about, we know all that already. What I was really interested in was honestly their growth as human beings, their growth politically, their growth as men, because you know ultimately the question that I don't want to say try to answer, the question I wanted to put on the table was, what if any social responsibility does the Black artist have? You know, that's really what I was trying to, that's the discussion I wanted to have, because you know what? It's a discussion that was happening 100 years before these guys. It was a discussion that was happening with W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington. And it's a discussion that's still happening right now. You know, it's a discussion that goes on inside my head every time before I'd say yes or no on an assignment that in one way or another kind of feels like it might compromise my morals, which is, you know, Hollywood.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, when you're Black, when you're a person of color, when you're someone who's underrepresented, those decisions have a lot more weight. And you know, I see these four men as less representative of the civil rights movement, but more the nascent Black Power movement, the Black Power movement before it was called that. So I wanted to show people coming into that Black Power manner of thinking, you know, and do it in a thoughtful way. Again, it was about being thoughtful. And you still show the foibles, of course, but it's not really about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, I really,
it was struck by, you know, the characters, they're having these really deep, or, you know, conversations and arguments and discussions. And, you know, at certain times, one character or another is, you know, really pissed off at one of them. But at the end of the day, this is a, you know, a group of people who all truly respect each other and come back together and, you know that, like, yeah, you might have popped off on that, but I know where you're coming from. That really just, you know, struck me. It didn't sensationalize those bets.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that, man, because, you know, there's always a question, you know, as screenwriters of conflict. And I feel like, I remember once someone was like, are the stakes high enough in this? And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, these men's lives are literally in danger. You're looking at the decisions they're making through your modern paradigm, your modern prism. Look at it through the prism of what they're doing, how they're living right now. And their lives are in danger on a daily basis. And again, it's funny how when we discuss things like stakes and stuff, how artists of color, particularly Black artists telling Black stories, seem to have to operate from a different standpoint. Because, you know, I watched films like 12 Angry Men. I watched films like The King's Speech, for which Tarek Anwar was our editor. He edited The King's Speech, where it's like, this guy has a stutter, but he's a really important individual, and he needs to get over his stutter to inspire people. So if you can't tell me that, like, my stakes are, I don't know. It's just, it's really interesting when people kind of start nitpicking about, and I'm not saying people are right or wrong. It's a matter of taste is my point. But I think that even though it's these small human moments, I think the stakes are massive for each of these four men.
I mean, I think the opening of the film, certainly the way each character is introduced and the sort of, you know, what we would call today even microaggressions or things like that, the treatment that they're forced to put up with, the scene with Jim Brown going to visit Beau Bridges, you know, I kind of sensed that shoe was going to drop, but when it does, it's just such a gut punch. And it really, you when you're talking about stakes, like the everyday stakes that these characters are having to deal with couldn't be larger.
Yeah. It's the banality of the racism. You know what I mean? That, like, I think if you went back and you talked to Beau Bridges' character, not him, not Beau Bridges the man, but the character he's playing, that character would say he is supportive of Black people. You know, like, even though he literally calls him the N-word in his face.
Yeah.
Because and that's real. You know, that's very real. And a character like Jim in that moment where he's been sent there on behalf of his aunt, who he obviously loves very much, and he doesn't want to cause any stink that could, you know, bounce back and negatively impact her. This man who's so powerful has to sit there and just grind his teeth. And you talk about things like that moment for me really was trying to demonstrate what Black anger feels like. You know, like, you're grinding your teeth and suppressing and pushing down. James Baldwin said it best, right? The murderous rage that you have to walk around your entire life with. That's an example of the thing that James Baldwin said so eloquently. I wanted to show it.
And that's when you're Jim Brown, like, you're this beloved, famous athlete, soon to be movie star, and you have to deal with it the same way, you know, same way anybody else does.
Yeah. In today's parlance, what would you say? Just shut up and dribble, right? That's what they tell LeBron. Yep. You know, it's just like, it's as much as things have changed, kind of have they?
I mean, that's unfortunately, you know, the parallels to today, you know, change going to come. It's still a long ways to go. Yeah. I'm curious, you know, you mentioned, you know, you're coming, you started this, you know, as a book. So when did you first learn about this, this night, this sort of inflection point that these four guys were together?
I would say, I think it was about 10 years ago. I believe. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't. It was actually a book by the late Mike Marcucci, really great British-born, American-raised sports writer. He wrote this book called Redemption Song: Muhammed Ali and the Spirit of the '60s. And it was a book. I'm a sports fan too. You know, I'm a history buff. And it was about the intersection between sports and the civil rights movement. Really fascinating book. There was just one paragraph that mentioned it. That was the first time I saw it mentioned. Mm-hmm. And it was literally one paragraph. And so I just set about buying, interviewing any book that had ever been written on any of those four men. I just started scooping them all up and with the intention of just connecting the dots. And it was kind of interesting because you could connect the dots after a while. I mean, it's a combination of books and like declassified FBI files. You know what I mean? Like that's the other weird, strange thing is that the FBI was following all these guys around.
Yeah.
So once all that became public record, you're like, oh, I can see who was in what city at what time.
Literally in some cases.
It literally says Malcolm was here with this, with the crooner, Sam Cooke and Jim Brown. And it's like, yeah, the FBI was tailing them anyway. So you're able to kind of connect the dots and put together the pieces. And I got to say, those discoveries were exciting. Reading biographies about, there's worse fates in the world of research and reporting than reading endless amounts of information about these four men. They're all endlessly fascinating. Each one of them could have a whole television series devoted to their life stories, cradle to the grave. And Jim Brown is actually still with us. Mm-hmm. So it was fascinating because they all, you also realize that during that era when segregation was still very real, how much these public personas intersected with each other in a very, very casual ways. I mean, now when we live in an Instagram world where it's like, it's cool for famous people to take photos together. But it's like, did people know that Nina Simone was Malcolm X's next door neighbor? You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. I don't know.
I did not know that.
There you go. Like, you know, if we're concentrated in certain cities, you know, if you were in LA, you were in, you know, and you, depending on how much, you were either in Watts or you were in Baldwin Hills. If you're like, I live in Baldwin Hills now, you know, if you were in New York, you were in Harlem, you were in parts of Brooklyn, like you were in parts of Queens. We like they were all intersecting with each other and on a very regular basis. I mean, it's very much shades of what we read about in the Harlem Renaissance. Those interactions didn't just stop at the Harlem Renaissance. They continued through the civil rights era as well. You know, Malcolm X was a dishwasher with Red Fox when he was 19 years old.
Wow.
They were dishwashers in the same cotton club style segregated club in Harlem. So, Wow. Yeah, like, you know, I wrote another play just about that. Called The Two Reds, because Malcolm was Detroit Red and Red Fox was Chicago Red. So that's because they were both redheaded, light-skinned mm-hmm. Negroes. So yeah, you could.
Wow.
there's so many incredible stories about, you know, buried within these guys' lives. But that particular night is a flashpoint. What made it so powerful is what I tried to show in the film is that each of them was going through a crucible moment of their lives. All four of them. And that really, like, they were all having this crucible moment at the same time. And they all experienced transformative change shortly after that. I think it was 3 weeks after that night when Malcolm had left the Nation of Islam. Cassius Clay's name had been changed to Muhammad Ali. That next season was Jim Brown's last in the NFL. He retired from the set of The Dirty Dozen. Which is what we show in the film.
Yeah, that's a story, you know, like, familiar with. Yeah.
Like, I don't have to make any of that shit up. Like, it's just mm-hmm. all right there. And Malcolm and Sam were both dead less than 1 year from that night. And Malcolm's book, the autobiography, didn't get published till after he died. Sam only saying A Change Is Going to Come one time in his entire life publicly on the Johnny Carson show. And the single didn't come out till after he died.
Wow.
So he never saw the impact of his song. And Malcolm never saw the impact of his famous autobiography. I mean, that's Hollywood doesn't need to make it up. That's just the facts.
That's amazing. Well, I mean, at least with this film now, some of that legacy will get to be a bit more publicly known.
I hope so. I mean, of course, the conversation is fictional, but I just hope people know that it's powered by the truth. The thing I play with the most is timelines. You know what I mean? Like,
sure.
I believe that Sam technically performed on Carson a week or two before that night, performed A Change Is Going to Come. He had mm-hmm. just written the song, but I believe he performed it that one time right before the night. So I play a little bit with sure. time, but I play more with time than I do with fact. Mm-hmm. That's for sure.
That's, I mean, it's all there. And I mean, like you said, it is just a crazy inflection point
yeah.
when you think about it now, looking back at what happened with all those guys. So when you're researching it, are you laying out the timelines for these characters, like the parallel timelines, and then trying to, you know, kind of piece it together? Or was you just immersing yourself in it and then letting it come out naturally on the page?
I started with the debate. And I started with the central debate, which was that between Malcolm and Sam. That was the central. I think the first pages that I wrote of script were the high point, you might call it, of the Sam and Malcolm argument, when Malcolm basically plays Bob Dylan's Blowing in the Wind. That those are some of the first pages that I wrote. The whole argument, starting with Sam talking about empowerment and the Rolling Stones going through to the Malcolm thing, because I wanted Sam to make such an airtight argument that the people in the audience will go like, absolutely, he's absolutely right. And then Malcolm on a dime to have a mic drop retort that's equally correct, which really kind of does something to you when you just go like, this character couldn't be more correct. And then the retort is also correct, mm-hmm. and just undermines everything the character says. So that started, that was the first bit of dialogue, but I don't really get into script until I'm a maniacal about my beat sheets. So I almost over outline, to be perfectly honest, you know, and I spend so much time outlining and doing beat sheets and dropping tidbits of dialogue in that by the time I'm ready to kind of start writing the script, like 80% of the work is kind of done. And I'm talking about the first draft. I'm then going to rewrite the goddamn thing 5 times. But you know what I mean? The hardest work for me is the first draft. That's just brutal, getting to the words, the end. And when I mapped out the timeline, which I did do, it was very helpful for me because, you know, the timeline might clash with the story that I'm trying to tell. Not that much, but enough. But you know what I mean? Like in the film, we show Cassius taking those photos underwater at the Sir John Hotel. That actually happened like months before that, you know, and we put it on the day, but it was just, mm-hmm. you know, an iconic moment. Like I said, Sam performing on the Tonight Show, you know, I inverted that, you know, things like that, but it serves the story so well that, so again, that's why, again, it's a work of fiction powered by the truth, but the fiction is more about, you know, the chain, playing around with timelines to serve the central themes and to serve the central conflict in the story. You know, I always wanted to structure this not as we see these men today, which is, of course, Muhammad Ali is one of the most famous athletes who's ever lived. Malcolm X is probably one of the most famous civil rights, you know, activists who's ever lived. Going back to that night when Cassius was 22, Jim Brown was 28, and Malcolm and Sam were in their 30s, the most famous person in the room was Sam Cooke, followed closely by Jim Brown. And so for me, the structure was that of a younger brother and his three older brothers fighting over him making a big decision. That decision would be like, hey, I'm going to go fight in the Vietnam War. Hey, I'm not going to go to college. Like, that's what I wanted to structure it as. Cassius is the little brother. We obviously see flourishes of what is going to become Muhammad Ali. But the semi-central conceit was that Muhammad Ali, who the public persona of Muhammad Ali, was simply a combination of Malcolm, Jim, and Sam. That's what I was coming from, you know, is like, what elements of Muhammad Ali were Sam? What elements of him are Malcolm? And what elements of him are Jim? So
that's fascinating. You know, maybe the most sort of powerful moment for me is the scene where at the Boston concert for Sam Cooke, Malcolm's there and, his mic is sabotaged. And as he starts to sing, the camera is pulling back and you can't even hear him by the time you get to where Malcolm is. That was just, to me, that like encapsulated everything that that character was trying to say. It was just such a wonderful way to visualize it.
Yeah. And I mean, you got to give like Regina and Tammy, like a lot of, you know, it's written on the page, but the way they executed it, the first time I saw that in dailies, I thought that was so cool that like they actually put the camera amongst the audience and mm-hmm. started backing away so that we gradually don't hear him. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that made it, to me, 10 times more powerful than what I'd written. I love that moment too. And that's really, you know, the Boston show for the film is really a composite of several shows. You know, there was no one Boston show. Jackie Wilson was notorious for sabotaging Sam. There's actually videos available where like there was one where Sam was singing Everybody Loves to Cha-Cha-Cha and Jackie pops up on stage with him and lip syncs along, you know, and it's just like, you know, it's like that was par for the course in those, during those reviews where you're performing with all these different artists. And it's been spoofed in a million different movies. But yeah, it was really meant to be a composite of a whole bunch of different Sam, you know, experiences. And Malcolm did first become aware of Sam because a lot of brothers were like, I want to hang out by the, like when he was at the Apollo, it was getting a lot of attention in Harlem. Mm-hmm. And so they really did first meet in Harlem, separate from Muhammad Ali.
That's very fascinating. You mentioned Regina. So can you talk a little bit about adapting your own play for the screen and working with her to turn this into a, you know, a huge movie?
It's been quite a journey because when I wrote the play, I didn't have any real intention on adapting it into a film. It's interesting because the plays had quite a positive life. It's played on several different continents, but for all its successes, the play has also run up against a lot of walls, a lot of places that didn't want to produce the play. And so I kind of started wondering, like, I think this is such an important story and it feels like there's limited outlets for me to get this story out. Can I reimagine it as a film? And that's just because that's where my career was going. You know, like I was writing for film and television. And I say that and that, you know, people assume, or maybe they don't assume, that if you're a playwright that you can write screenplays and write for TV. But to me, each one of them, I had to kind of take a step back to square one. Mm-hmm. So, you know, being a cool, hot playwright didn't mean shit. I still had to go and become a staff writer on my first TV show. You know what I mean? And similarly, like you gotta step back and learn the craft again and again and again. And so as I was getting to a point where I was getting a lot more interested in doing feature work, that's when I was like, okay, I think I want to give this a shot, because my hesitance for letting someone else option it and adapt it was that I was afraid that they would turn it into a very different kind of film. The very film that people who gave me notes for the play said, we want more of a play about Muhammad Ali. People don't know who Jim Brown is. People don't know much about Sam Cooke. That's not what's interesting. You focused on the wrong thing. And no part of me ever felt like I focused on the wrong thing telling this story. And I felt like if I option this and let someone else take it, that's exactly where they're going to go. They're going to go like, who's an A-list star we can convince to play Muhammad Ali? And that will be the building block of the movie. And it'll fuck the whole story up. So I figured, you know, the producers, Abco Films with Jody Klein and Snoop, Keith and Jess Calder, when they decided to do it, they agreed to let me take a stab at adapting it myself. And I figured like, okay, I'm going to adapt it. And you know how it is with screenwriters. It's like you'll hire someone better later on. Mm. But at the very least, maybe I can at least sell you guys on a template so that when you bring in other writers to do the writing, then you might at least kind of hold enough to this structure. But I remember a great conversation, a friend of mine, it was Max Brooks. He wrote the book World War Z. And he and I were sitting down having dinner one time. And I asked him, I was like, so, you know, like, how does it feel seeing that the movie and like none of your book is in that? And and he was like, oh no. He's like, I optioned it. When you option your work, you got to let that shit go. You know what I mean? He's like, you cannot be angry. You cannot be anything. It's like, unless you want to do it yourself, you have to know that if it's going to become source material, it's just that. And I really took what Max said to heart. So I was like, okay, you know, even with me writing this draft, I know it's going to be rewritten. But then they sent the draft out. And when it came time to get directors, I really urged the producers to go with a first time or new director, because I felt like someone who had more skin in the game, just talent, who hadn't had, this could be a real breakout film for someone. Mm-hmm. And just my luck, one of the first people who saw it was Regina, and she wanted to meet me. So she was filming Watchmen at the time. We hopped on a phone. What was it? It was a Skype call, because I didn't even know what the hell Zoom was, but Zoom didn't exist. No one knew Zoom didn't exist back then.
Before times.
Yeah. This is like, you know, earlier in 2019. This is before she even won her Oscar. So I was actually already at Pixar working on Soul. And so I was in like Emeryville. She was in Atlanta. We had this great like 3-hour conversation. She really loved the script. She read the play and was amazed by how she was like, I couldn't believe the same person wrote both. You know, like people comment on the film being very stagey and theatrical, but it's like, I don't think they know how different it is. Like The most popular parts of the play aren't even in the movie. Like I burned it down and started over. So, and so I was like, oh, that's great. Well, I really hope, I know you'll do a great job with it. And she was like, well, I'm going to be working with you. And I was like, what do you mean? Like, I didn't know that she wanted me to stay on as a writer. She's like, no, I want to work with you. I love your voice. So that was like all Regina. The fact that I kind of stayed on for the whole process. I got made an executive producer and got more involved in the film, you know, casting everything, which is, you know, kind of the opposite of, I think, the typical screenwriters, you know, first time screenwriters experience where you're kind of used to like washing your hands of it. And instead it was like, no, we want you, because of Regina, she was like, I want you more involved because I really like what you've done.
Wow. Yeah. So you mentioned Soul, you've got these movies coming out within, you know, basically in the same month.
Same day,
I guess. That's a position a screenwriter rarely gets, finds himself in. What's that like for you right now? It must be pretty exciting.
It's surreal. It's it's surreal, exhausting. I mean, no, seriously, like I didn't know what promoting a film entailed. This is all very, very new to me. And I'm also not accustomed to people wanting to talk to the writer. That's the other thing. I mean, with Soul is different because I'm also the co-director. So, but I'm not accustomed as a writer. I'm used to people doing every, one of my favorite writer jokes I've ever heard was on 30 Rock. When do you remember the episode where they're like, this Steven Spielberg's doing this new movie and it's being written by the best screenplay in Hollywood, whoever that is. Like, that was my favorite. I'm like, that pretty much encapsulates how writers are seen. So I'm just not used to people wanting to know what's on my mind this much. And so that's been a little bit of an adjustment. I'm not a shy person or anything like that, you know, but I am definitely like a private guy. And it's also weird because you have these films that are getting a lot of attention, but it's COVID. And like, I've been doing all this from my damn kitchen table. So you know what I mean? It's like, we got into all these film festivals and didn't get to go. I didn't get to go to any of them. You know, Soul got into Cannes. Cannes got canceled. You know, we didn't go to Venice, obviously. We didn't go to BFI in London. You know, it was New Yorker Festival. I've been sitting here in LA for the last 9 months promoting these movies, and it's very bizarre and very surreal. But I do feel lucky. I mean, the fact that we got them done, the fact that they got made, period, because both of the films were impacted by COVID. We wrapped principal photography on one night in Miami a week before the lockdown, but we still had two pickup days to do, two very pivotal scenes. So we were actually one of the first productions to ramp back up and shoot again. And it was tense. You know, we had to get this whole crew COVID tested. Then we had to wait for several days and for the results to come back. There were a few inconclusives. And then like, it was just really like, oh my God, if we don't get these scenes, we can't finish the movie. And you know, we were already accepted into Toronto and Venice. So it's like, we got to get these scenes so that we can be in these film festivals. Similarly, Soul, we still had 40% of the film to animate when we shut down. But The one thing about animation, it was pretty amazing what Systems was able to do, getting people set up at home so that the animators could keep working. So that was a really, really smooth.
Oh, that's absolutely crazy. You mentioned, you know, your previous life as a journalist. I'm curious, you know, when did you have that first inkling that you were going to be a storyteller, that you wanted to tell stories?
I think in college. I started off, I mean, writing for my school paper, and I started a comic company with some friends. I wrote indie comics when I was, you know, 19 years old. And I loved it. It was like the one thing I felt that I was good at. I should say the one sellable thing, the one thing that could be a career that I was good at, because I wasn't really good at anything useful. Like, I did taekwondo, so I could like roundhouse kick someone in the head. I could play a little bit of saxophone, you know, like nothing really useful, nothing useful to the world. But, you know, and it was a great English teacher who freshman year, she was like, you're really good at this. You should like go to the school paper and start writing. And I just fell in love with it. I mean, I'm a Gen X kid. I'm a nerd of the 80s. And so, you know, we all grew up fascinated with and in love with comic books and you know, the same. I don't have to tell you any of this. I mean, it's just, I almost lament that our generation kind of became the popular generation in terms of what's out there, because I feel like we might have ruined the thing that we loved. Yeah. When you...
there seem to be other forces at play that might, you know, might be bringing it back down a little bit.
Yeah. So it was that. I just was like, honestly, it started with me just wanting to write comic books, man. And I just, you know, I was writing for the school paper and we were doing these comics, going to conventions. It was really, really cool, you know, to kind of just be telling stories that people were interested in. And that's what I fell in love with. And that's, I've always described myself as a storyteller. I've said the medium might change, but I think of myself as really observant and a good listener. All I'm doing now is, like, after interviewing and talking to thousands and thousands of people as a journalist, I just have a bottomless resource of characters and voices and ideas rolling around in my head. So it really does help. It really did help my writing as I moved into, you know, screenwriting and playwriting. And I'm not the only one. I think there's a lot of former journalists who moved into playwriting and screenwriting. And I think those, the combination of the research reporting character, focusing on being observant and having very thick skin, because you have to have incredibly thick skin as a journalist, I think those things all really serve you well.
Mm-hmm. Well, they certainly have served you well. One last question as we wrap up. Is there something you've learned along the way, you know, especially as a screenwriter, that you go back and tell that journalist who's about to transition to screenwriting, or that guy who's making comics in college? Is there something you've learned that you wish you could go back and tell yourself?
It's hard to do. It's collaborative. And collaboration, everyone says they're like down with collaboration in theory, but then most people aren't. Everyone wants to be the person making the final decision until they finally are, and they don't. And it's hard. It's hard to make good work. I can't stress that enough. The fact that anything I write, that the end result ends up not being a heaping pile of shit, amazes me, because it is really. And the irony is, the people doing it love it, are passionate, and are talented, but there's so many factors, conflicting factors at play that fuck things up. You know what I mean? That fuck up our art. That I understand, you know, and honestly, and I envy those personalities who've kind of just like walked away, and like the Vim Vendors of the world, who's like, fuck it, I'm going back to Berlin. You know what I mean? Like, I totally get it. I totally, you know what I mean? I
he's not getting to make Wings of Desire today.
Yeah, you know, like I love that Jim Jarmusch just like can do a movie. You know, like
he knew Patterson about a poetry writing bus driver, and just that's what it is.
Yeah, man, like that's the real power to me, the ability to just even be able to get your art made. And it's so goddamn hard. I gotta say, like, everything that I get done feels like a miracle. And I treat it as such. That's why I think I'm this is surreal, and I'm appreciative of everything that's happening, but I also know tomorrow, none of it matters. It's like, so what do you got next? You know, like, it's always just like, what do you got next, man? Like, if I could talk to people in the past, I was like, you have no idea how much resilience is going to be necessary to make a go of this, you know, because there's no overnight anything. We know this. There's no overnight success. It's just, God, the resilience you need.
I think that's a great place to end it. Kemp, thank you so much for taking the time to chat. Congrats on the films, I should say. I haven't had a chance to see Soul yet, but I'm sure it's incredible. And good luck with everything.
Thanks, man. I really appreciate it.
Thanks to Kemp Powers for coming on the show. One Night in Miami opens in select theaters where it's safe on Christmas Day and will be streaming on Amazon Prime on January 15th. Check it out. And of course, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review, and if you haven't already, subscribe on Apple Podcasts. For news about future episodes and more, like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter @FinalDraftInc and on Instagram @FinalDraftScreenwriting. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess. Editing and post-production done by Sadie Dean. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, write on.